Harvest dinner, and she tunes in every week, but she missed the snow, so hi, Joe, you're down in Arizona soaking up the sunshine, and we got a couple inches of snow here, but it's good, glad to see you this morning. Hey, gonna run through some announcements here. We are gonna deck the halls. We're gonna be decorating the church sanctuary tomorrow evening, November 27th at 6 p.m. All help is appreciated there. You want to come by, help decorate the sanctuary for Christmas, really kick in the Christmas spirit there. It's already been kicked off with the snow. The Operation Christmas Child shoeboxes, they were sent out last weekend. Crystal said that we had 34 physical boxes, and she knows of at least five that were packed online from our congregation. Great job, and thank you so much to everybody who made a box, who went online and did a box that way. What a great way to share the love of Jesus through a shoebox gift. The annual congregational meeting is December 10th, following our worship service. I want you guys to be aware of that. The candidates for affirmation for their 2024 elders, deacons, trustees, they've been posted on the bulletin board above the glass cabinet in the overflow room. Also, want you to be aware that the board has proposed an amendment to the church bylaws to change that annual meeting from the first weekend in December from December 10th to the second Sunday in January. So from the second Sunday in December to the second Sunday in January. That's been posted in the overflow room as well. So view it, pray about it. Be ready for to vote on that as well. The Food Pantry Ministry, we want to thank you so much to the C-Cops group for hosting a food drive at local food pantries and then dropping them off at our food pantry. It came in and it went out just as fast as it was coming in. So what an opportunity to just to help some folks, especially the holiday season. The Clark County Sheriff's Department dropped off some meals that we got to go out and give to some families as well. So big thanks to them for reaching out and just sharing love this time of year. So some dates that you can save here. December 7th is going to be the Women's Council Christmas at 12 p.m. December 10th is that annual congregational meeting following our worship service. December 13th is going to be the Ladies' Christmas Party at 7 p.m. We're going to have some more details on that. December 17th is our children's Christmas program during that Sunday school hour. And December 24th, we're going to have our worship service as normal. 10:45 to 11:45 is Sunday school for adults, and they're going to have Jesus' birthday party. So no little kids. Sunday school, it'll be that Christmas party. And then at 6 p.m. on Christmas Eve, we're going to do our candlelight Christmas Eve service. Any other announcements that I missed should be aware of? Hey, some folks that we can pray for, continue to pray for. The family of Merrill Carnes, Jr. This is Casey's grandpa. If you would, continue to pray for the family of Rick Hansen and all those involved there. And praying for the family of Jerry Duggar, the family of Kathy Smith. If you would, continue to pray for Owen as he's recovering from surgery and chemotherapy. To follow, haven't heard anything, just recovering. Okay. Got out and drove around. Well, that's good. He's home recovering, starting to feel a little better there. So really a praise God on there. We have another praise God. Brian's getting another daughter. He had all these boys, and he's just starting to collect these daughters along the way. But a big congratulations to Colin McCracken and Emily Feinhold on the announcement of their engagement. So yeah, absolutely. That's exciting stuff. Is there any others that we can add to our prayer list this week? All right, Coach Jensen, Danny Jensen is going in for some surgery in the upcoming weeks. You think it's when?
December 13th.
December 13th, okay. Yeah, pray for Jens there. Did you have one? What was it? What? God the Father. Yes, we are here to praise God. Absolutely. Love it. Well, would you pray with me this morning, Father? As we come before you, we are so thankful for all that you've done, God, the many ways that you have blessed us, Lord, the opportunity to gather here to praise your name. We thank you so much, Father, for sending your Son, Lord, to free us, to give us honest liberation from sin. God, we thank you so much for the cross. Thank you for the tomb, even, God, and we thank you so much for the resurrection that guarantees our resurrection someday. We look forward to that day, God, to be with you. Until then, may we just be filled with a heart of worship. In Jesus' name, amen. So, this is conviction time with the autos. I don't know why. We just drive sometimes, or we just talk about all the ways that we're being convicted. You ever do that? It's not really like a fluffy, good conversation. But one of the ways that I have been feeling convicted, that we have been feeling convicted, is we have to witness better. We have to witness more. How is your witness going? Are you witnessing to people around you about what God is doing? And I know it's something that we always say, you know, I should do that better. And we should, right? But I started feeling this, I should be doing it better. But it also carries with it, I have to do this better. I have to do this better. I have to witness to people about the good news of Jesus Christ, right? So I asked the question, and so many times I think Megan helps me out more than I help her out in these things. I'm just struggling with stuff, right? Wrestling around with it. So how do we do that better? How do we do that better? How do I witness to people better? And I guess what we came to the conclusion to, or what Megan suggested, and I think she's on the right track, and I think it falls right in line with what we're going to talk about today, is my witness, my yearning to witness to other people about the good news of Jesus, about what God is doing, is recognizing what God is doing in your life now. Because I feel like that comes from an overflow of what God is doing in your life. That want, that yearning to share Jesus with people comes from an overflow of your worship. The way that you're worshiping God, the way that he is working and filling up your life spills over and it has nowhere to go except for to the people around you. And that comes from a true heart of worship. It's so easy to get focused on me, and things that are going on that I forget to slow down and just worship God for who he is. We talked last week about how that picture, that gratitude picture, gets pretty small when I'm just focused on me or the things that are going on around me. But to be filled with worship is to step back and look at that big picture. And as an overflow of what God is doing in my life and the way that I am worshiping him, I have no choice but to just tell of all the good things that God has done in my life. And most importantly, the greatest thing he's done in my life is turn me around. He made me a new person. I'm brand new. 2 Corinthians 5:17. Anyone who is in Christ Jesus is a brand new creation. The old is gone. Thank God that the old Eddie is dead and gone, buried. And the new has come. So we're going to rejoice in that today and always. We're going to stand up as we continue to worship this morning.
Great is thy faithfulness, great. Well, we may have experienced troubled relationships that felt us feeling weary or even afraid of trusting someone's promise of love. We may even feel this way about God's love, wondering where the catch is. There is, however, no catch. But while we were still sinners, but God showed his great love for us by sending Christ to die for us while we were still sinners. In Romans chapter 5, verses 6 through 10, it says, "You see, at just the right time, when we were still powerless, Christ died for the ungodly. Very rarely will anyone die for a righteous person, though for a good person, someone might possibly dare to die. But God demonstrates his own love for us in this. While we were still sinners, Christ died for us. Since we have now been justified by his blood, how much more shall we be saved from God's wrath through him? For if while we were God's enemies, we were reconciled to him through the death of his son. How much more, having been reconciled, shall we be saved through his life?" Eventually, we realize that God already proven his love by dying for us. When our sinful state separated us from God, he reached out to us by giving Jesus to die on our behalf. Because of this, our sins are forgiven, and we can look forward to eternity with him. Whenever we wonder whether we can truly trust God's love, let's remember what Christ did for us on the cross. We can trust his promise of love, knowing that he is faithful. Let's pray. Dear Lord, we thank you so much for this wonderful day you've given us. We thank you for your son, Jesus, that you sent to die on the cross for us so our sins can be forgiven. Help us as we take this communion, Lord, to examine our hearts and to realize what you went through for us in doing this. And just please forgive us and help us to have a wonderful week. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Thanks, Vicky, for reminding us that God is with us and that he is faithful always. Today, I want to take you to a place in the Psalms, Psalm 40. If you have your Bibles, open up to Psalm 40. I'm going to ask you to do something that we do once in a while here. I'm going to ask you to stand up and honor God's word as it's read today, but also going to ask you to do something with me. I'm going to ask you to engage in God's word. The scripture's on the screen, but if you need a better look, I would like you to help me out and engage in scripture this morning. So if you would, please stand. I will recite a verse, I'll share with you a verse, and then you read the next verse to me, okay? So that both of us can engage in Scripture. So minister to you and minister to me today, and let's do this together. And let's practice really hearing Lord's Word and not just speaking it today, okay? Let's catch this because it has a lot to do with our lives. Our lives need to be lives of worship because our worship life goes along with thankfulness, doesn't it? And we just experienced that. We just celebrated that. And our worship and thankfulness will lead to a witness that can't be muffled, can't be stifled by the world. It will be heard because it will not be silenced. So I hope you hear that as we read this psalm. This is a psalm of David. This was actually at some point sung out to music. And this scripture speaks to us today and reminds us of the importance and place in worship. I believe that God right now is teaching our church how important worship is. How important worship is in our hearts and lives. We went through It's really important, isn't it? We went through a time where we studied the book of Revelation, and time again we saw the significance of worship. This fall we undertook the book of Exodus. One of the things that we are studying throughout the book of Exodus is the importance and the place of worship, and what it really means as I begin to learn, instead of declaring my own wants and needs, to declare daily the worth of God. Will you do that with me as we read scripture today? I waited patiently for the Lord. He turned to me and he heard my cry. Verse 2. He put a new song. He put a new song in my mouth, a hymn of praise to our God. Many will see and fear the Lord and put their trust in him. Many, Lord my God, are the wonders that you have done, are the things that you have planned for us. None can compare with you. Were I to speak and tell of all your deeds, they would be too many to declare. Then I said, check this out. Then I said, here am I. I have come. It is written about me in the scroll. I proclaim your saving acts in the great assembly. I do not seal my lips, Lord, as you know. Do not withhold your mercy from me, Lord. May your love and faithfulness always, always protect me. Be pleased to save me, Lord. Come quickly. Lord, help me. May those who say to me, aha, aha, be appalled at their own shame. That as for me, I'm poor and needy. May the Lord think of me. You are my help. You are my deliverer. You are my God. Do not delay. Let's pray this morning. Father, as we come to you and we read your word, we're reminded just who you are and what you desire in our lives. Lord, this day we pray with David, do not withhold your mercy. Be quick to save. Father, thank you for helping us through all of life's snares. And may we, as we reflect on that, may we worship you. May we day by day not focus on the negatives that are so easy to point out in this world because it's broken. But may we focus on the promises, the positive promises that you have given us that are ours in Jesus Christ. Father, may you begin to well up in us a heart of worship in a world that is dark, for it brings light. It brings to light the goodness of God, the glory of God, the purpose of God, and the plan of God. And Father, we want to be walking in your will. So help us to give thanks with a grateful heart to the one who gave his all for us. I thank you, Father, that while I was your enemy, you came and died for me and saved me. Lord, you're rich in mercy. You're rich in mercy. And you are my deliverer. You are my God. And you do not delay. We thank you for this in Jesus' name. Amen. You may be seated. How many of you have been to Yellowstone? Have you been to Yellowstone National Park? You've been there? What was one of the things you saw in Yellowstone National Park that you remember? The what's that? Oh, okay. Yeah. Some of those pools that have really interesting colors and different colored waters. Anybody else? What do you remember? Old Faithful. Old Faithful. I remember when my family visited Yellowstone National Park. Yellowstone is kind of a geological hotbed. Hundreds of geysers and hot springs all around this one area. And one of those geysers is known affectionately as Old Faithful. Why? It's old. Okay, let's get obvious here. It's old and it's? Yes, okay. So right now, about every 80 minutes, Old Faithful spouts off. It's not the tallest geyser, probably not the most majestic or beautiful, but it is faithful. You can count on Old Faithful about every 80 minutes right now to go off. And on the day we went to Yellowstone, we arrived about half an hour, 45 minutes to spare, as I remembered. Lisa could probably tell a different story, but that's okay. The National Park Service had built a boardwalk around there, and there were motels and gift shops. They all fan out from this geyser. No doubt about it, Old Faithful is one of probably the centerpieces of Yellowstone National Park. And the time for the eruption got closer, and as it did, more and more tourists joined our family. And sitting on the benches or on the boardwalk, latecomers kind of had to stand farther back. And this was in a day when people still had cameras. Kids, let me tell you about this. A camera is this thing that has nothing to do with your phone. It has film in it, and you actually push a button and you take a picture. Really? Yeah, okay. Kind of like that, all right? And video cameras. I mean, it wasn't all encompassed in your one little iPhone, you know, there. They had video cameras. I mean, people were bringing out tripods, and all this was happening just to see Old Faithful erupt. From the steam, this famous hole in the ground begins to kind of steam up, and as the time got closer, there's this sputtering sound. "There she goes," exclaimed one observer who thought he was in the know. But the sputtering kind of went back. If you've been there, the sputtering kind of went back down, and I refrained from any more comments. And a moment later, the sputtering came back up again, and all of a sudden it turns into this fountain of hot water steaming toward the heavens, hundreds of feet high. Everybody is sitting there, jaws wide open, looking up into the air at this geyser, just a bunch of steam streaming toward the heavens. The sense of wonder filled everybody encircling Old Faithful as the geyser sent its cascading waters up and up. Well, the crowd was kind of spellbound. They were awe-filled, and the dancing water performed its magic for a minute and then quietly returned to earth. Well, its water supply was depleted, but in another 80 minutes, the underground plumbing would be filled again, ready to burst towards the sky. And more onlookers would come and would witness its majesty. And I kind of tucked something in my heart that day, apparently, that came about when I read this 40th Psalm. All the people looking at Old Faithful Geyser all of a sudden displayed this sense of awe, a worship-like quality. They had witnessed something powerful, something beyond themselves, and you'd hear people in the crowd say things. "Did you see that? That was amazing, wasn't it?" One dad was saying to his kids. A little boy was talking to his sister. "I can remember, I can't wait to tell my friends when I get back home." Another one shouted to Grandpa sitting on the bench back there. "Grandpa, did you see that?" Yeah. Still another person said, "Can we watch it again?" With a sense of reverence, people returned to their cars or the gift shop, knowing they had witnessed something spectacular. The question is, does the same dynamic occur when you come to worship God? Or, let me give this to you in a different setting. When you're out there just worshiping God day by day with every breath you take, are you in awe and wonder of who he is as he walks with you through your life? I know it's busy. Some of you have young kids right now, and some of you have houses full of family, multiple family. Sometimes we wonder just where in the world God fits into our lives. God fits into our lives when we recognize him first and foremost. We ought to witness on a daily basis the spectacular hand of God. See it in the small things, in the blessings that we are given so richly. We're supposed to witness to something beyond ourselves. We're supposed to be spellbound, in awe, mesmerized by the life-giving, life-flowing power of God. And it should motivate us to tell others about what we've experienced. You see, what Old Faithful does for the tourist in Yellowstone, our worship of God should do for those who worship God in the church. David wrote, and I'll read it to you again in the third verse, and that's kind of where we're going to focus today. "He, God, put a new song in my mouth, a hymn of praise." Do you hear that? Some new and some old. "A hymn of praise to our God. Many will see and fear. Many will see and fear and do what? What will they do? Why isn't the world, let me ask you a question, why isn't the world turning to Jesus like it should right now? The question becomes, are we really engaging in worship on an everyday basis? And church, I want to lay that on you. It's not a guilt trip. It's a God trip. Because he wants you to grow in this. He wants you to build in this. He wants you to be this. He wants you to be a person who is worshipful. There's some elements of worship that we see in this. The first is this. celebration is a vertical dimension. You see, David had an experience with God, and God had rescued him, and God had refreshed him. You ever go through those times in life where God, where you realize what God has done to rescue you? That he gave his only son to die, not for your goodness, but for the areas in your life where you are bankrupt. And David experienced that remembrance, that redemption that came from God. And it truly refreshed his soul. And isn't that interesting? David experienced the presence of God in his life, and he was changed, and he couldn't be silent about it. He said, I just burst forth and sang praise to God. Have you ever done that in life? Like a Disney, I used to make fun of all the Disney movies, you know, where people are just kind of walking through life and all of a sudden they sing. What inspires that? I don't even know what I just said. Will somebody interpret that for me? But he just burst forth in song. And I find myself every once in a while doing that with hymns like Great is Thy Faithfulness. With songs like You're a Good, Good Father. And sometimes it just pours out of my heart because God is present and walking with me. David was exuberant in song and in praise. He was excited and he couldn't contain his joy. And it overflowed. I like that word Eddie used. It overflowed from a heart full of worship. And he had to shout and sing. And some people looked at him like he was nuts. Some people made fun of him for dancing in the streets because the presence of God had come back to Jerusalem, dancing in the streets in his underclothing. His own daughter said, "Man, you didn't look like a king out there today, Dad. You look like a crazy man." And David looked at her and said, "I will become even more indignant than this if it comes to my worship life of who God is." You see, all of the Psalms were designed to be sung. And before we ever had a hymn book, the church just sang scripture, and there were new songs, and there were things that were added to it. Singing is mentioned explicitly 68 times in the Psalms, and it never says you have to sing good. It just says make a joyful noise, doesn't it? Yeah. In fact, some of my favorite people to sit around when they sing can't sing a lick. It's great to hear somebody just sing out because they're happy. I love that song. I sing because I'm happy, right? I had a professor in college. I loved to sit in front of him in chapel because he sang terrible. And it would just make me joyful to hear him sing. Because even though he couldn't carry a tune in a bucket, man, did he make a splash. And it wasn't just any song that David sang. It was a new song. No wonder Longfellow called the human voice the organ of the soul. There is a freshness and newness in David's life and in his experience with God every day. It was like somehow, and I don't know how to tell you to capture this, but it was like he was seeing God for the very first time in his life again. And I can't explain it to you if you've never experienced it, but sometimes when God just simply reveals himself to you in the quietness of your soul, it's like, wow, I had forgotten what that was like. Isn't that sad? Yesterday evening, it was snowing outside. Great news, right? Yeah, Lisa loves it. You know, the first song that came to my mind, it's beginning to look a lot like winter. I'm not ready for Christmas, folks, all right? Stepping out my door. Okay, I got my own song and it doesn't have any, but that's all right. I love the birth of Jesus Christ and the message that it brings. But I wasn't quite ready. But I went out and sat in the snow. And you're going to think I'm crazy. I went out and sat in the snow for about 2.5 hours and sat in a timber, climbed up a slippery deer stand for an old guy and sat up in there and I just watched these deer run past me and run around me in the snow, and there was just something about it that brought peace to me, deep peace, that reminded me it didn't matter if Nebraska lost to Iowa, because God is still in control of all things. It wasn't just any song that David sang. It was a song about God refreshing his heart and God doing for him what he had been doing for all along, and him recognizing it. It's like seeing Old Faithful erupt over and over again. I would love to go back. I want to go back someday with my boys now that they're grown up, now that they're married and engaged and all that kind of stuff. I want to take my grandchildren sometimes and be that grandpa sitting on the bench, and they have to wake me up for Old Faithful. I want to see it again. His singing was praiseful. It was worship. David expressed a song of gratitude for who God is and who he is. He said all about what he talked about was about what God was doing and what he had done. Because David knew the source of the goodness in his life was none other than God himself. That's the vertical dimension. But isn't it amazing? This captured me and really struck me again as I was reading this psalm. Just as there is a vertical dimension to worship, there's also a horizontal dimension. And I'm sorry that I hadn't incorporated this or preached this in life before. David said, when we worship the right way in the church and the right way in our lives outside the church building, when we worship the right way in the church, David says, many will see. And what David is saying, many will know that God is with you, his presence is there, and they will be in awe of him, even to the point of maybe being a little fearful in the right sense. And put their trust, motivate them to put their trust or find security in the Lord their God. As David praised, he made sure that it wasn't just something he kept to himself. He didn't do it for a performance in any way, shape, or form. But when David praised God, many people saw it because he couldn't contain it. I hate the times. I hate the times when when I'm preaching a sermon and God breaks me down in front of everybody and you start to cry. That's really not who I am. I'm not a crybaby. I'm a tough guy. You know, right? But it's okay to cry sometimes because God breaks you. David's joy and his weakness before the Lord was his witness. Did you catch that in this psalm? Both his joy in the Lord and his weakness in the Lord are David's witness. We don't have to be perfect. We don't have to be polished. We just have to be in the presence of God moment by moment as he leads us in our life. That's why when we come together, I want to remind you, we don't just worship when we gather on Sundays. It should be a constant attitude or activity of our lives as dedicated believers. When we come together, we do. We worship God corporately. And when the church gathers to worship, it also gathers to witness. I can't tell you how many people have said, wow, why don't you guys make a parking lot at that church up there? They're blocking off the streets some Sundays. There's a witness to that. It may be an inconvenience for some. There's also a witness that it's important for us to gather together. We'll make it in the snow. We'll make it in the sleet. We'll make it in the rain. Because God is the creator of all. Why does it happen? It's like a mystery, a marvel, a wonder. People begin to ask, why do those people even bother going and hearing that Brian McCracken guy? Why do they bother coming together to sing some songs and hear from Scripture? Hopefully they understand from your life that you're seeking God with everything you have. Let me show you in this psalm, there are also some products of worship. And like we've been talking about, the products of worship are amazing. The lost are drawn to Christ. When God's people experience the presence of God, when they meet God, it engages the heart, or it should. It changes the life that is touched. And consequently, somebody else that knew who you were once upon a time sees it and says, "What do you got now? Why are you changed?" Lost people are drawn into God's presence. You see, I want to invite you to embrace this. Right now in our world, there are a lot of people that are trapped in darkness and brokenness. They're trapped in despair and hopelessness. And if you shine the light of what Jesus' hope means in your life, they will take notice. William Booth was the founder of the Salvation Army, and he used to say in his messages, if a church was on fire for God, people from miles around would come to watch it burn. By the way, the opposite is equally true. What happens when a spiritually distant person sees boredom on the faces of worshipers? What if there's scowls and yawns? Will they be attracted to Christ? And as long as I'm getting personal, I want to step in a little bit closer. And I want to encourage you, parents. Remember, your children are watching you. And they're watching you in worship. Do they see the same excitement in you as when you go to a football game? Do they see you prepare for worship the same way as you do when you go on vacation? Do they see you hungry to arrive, to seek the face of the Father, and to fellowship with other believers? Children, like other non-believers, are watching. Believe me, they're watching you, and they're learning from your experience. Hey, it's up to each one of us to make worship come to life. And it shouldn't be a job or an obligation. It should be a joy. You may have to worship singing songs you don't know or songs you don't like, but who are you singing them to? The creator of the universe. And you should cry out to him like none other. Because one of the products of worship is the lost are drawn to Christ. But let me share you another one. And here's the one specifically for you today. The sent, or the saved, are sent out to share Christ. A quick review of the Bible reveals this. When people encounter God through worship, it affects their lives, and they go out and they share the message. Couple examples, one from the Old Testament, one from the New Testament. Isaiah 6, 1 through 8, I saw the Lord seated high and on a lofty throne, and his robe filled the temple. And Isaiah ends up singing, my eyes have seen the King, the Lord of hosts. And then I heard the loud voice of the Lord saying, who should I send? Who will go for us? And Isaiah couldn't resist it. He says, here am I, send me. Worship. And Isaiah was commissioned to go and speak to his people only after he had seen God in worship. Isaiah saw, he heard, and he responded. And if he had not entered into worship, really seeking God's glory and God's presence that day, he could have missed the calling of God on his life. How sad. In Matthew 28, the 11 disciples traveled to Galilee, several others with them, to a mountain where Jesus had directed them. And when they saw him, they worshiped. But, listen to what it says. They were a normal group of people. Some of them worshiped, but some of them doubted. Doubt this is going to do any good for me this week. Not going to pay my bills. You're not going to lift my spirits any. I'm just kind of grumpy this week. You been there? Man, I am so tired and worn out. I can't wait till the preacher preaches so I can get a good nap. Whatever it might be. Some of them doubted. Then Jesus came near to them. Isn't that interesting? When you're doubting and when you're hurting, guess who wants to draw near to you? Jesus. You know what? Sometimes when I see people that are in conflict, you know what I want to do? Run the stink another way. Not Jesus. Jesus draws near to you. And he says to them, listen, all authority has been given me in heaven and on earth. So I'm telling you, go, and as you're going, make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, teaching them to observe everything I have commanded you. And remember, I'm with you always to the end of the age. The Great Commission has to be the church's heartbeat and existence. But I want to remind you, it only overflows when we're engaged in worship. Honest worship. Worship of who God is. You see, the Great Commission was given following a time of worship when Jesus stood among his followers after he had died on a cross and been buried for 3 days. They worshiped him. They started to get who Jesus was and what he was about. Jesus was God in flesh. And he took time to be with them and love them and teach them an example to them. And that should be our response too. But here's the point. It was in the context of that worship that these men get to hear God's clear call to go to the world and represent Jesus. There are only two challenges of worship. They both depend on your honesty. Are you honestly here to celebrate God today? I hope that you work at that, because some mornings, I will tell you, the preacher gets up on some Sunday mornings, and I have to work at getting ready to worship God. But it has to be honest. I got up this morning. I'm starting to catch a little bit of a cold that my wife had all last week. Bless her heart. She was sick, like, all through Thanksgiving. So being the nice guy that I am, I ate all her pie, and I ate... Thank you, honey. I left her some stuff. But we need to come together with an honest heart of celebration of who God is. And sometimes we got to work at that. Sometimes we really got to work at that. The second thing is this. Is the vocation of your life, honestly, to share Jesus with others? Think about it. You can have lots of occupations. God says whatever you do, you can do it. But do it to the glory of God. Worship him as you're doing it. Are you honestly looking at your life as a witness to share the gospel of Jesus Christ, the good news that he saves imperfect people like me? If so, we want you to come today to Jesus and give your life to him and begin to worship him with everything you got. You know, worship happens sometimes in the strangest contexts when you don't even expect it. Can I share this with you just as we close? Yesterday morning was a worshipful day for me. It wasn't because I was standing behind a pulpit somewhere. It wasn't because I was dressed up nicely. It happened for me at Merrill Karn's funeral. And let me tell you why it happened. I met this young pastor that was doing the funeral, and he happened to be a pastor over at the Lutheran church over there. Nice young man, starting out in a church, just fresh with some little kids and all that kind of stuff. I couldn't help but see the smile on his face and the exuberance in his heart and the care and the passion that he had. And we stepped into this funeral service, and it was really, really different than anything I ever do in worship, because it was a Lutheran funeral service, but in it, people shared in the reading of Scripture. People responded when the pastor prayed. And I realize for some it could have been just religious ritual, just because it was written in a little piece of paper for us. But for me, it was something totally different. And I want to tell you that I was so glad, Casey, I was so glad that you invited me to your grandpa's funeral, because in a weird way, I know it's a weird way, and it wasn't just for me, but it was really worshipful. As I saw your grandpa's pictures up on the wall and the journey of his life and the smile on his face, you know what I said to myself? I've met that guy throughout life in Clark County. And I started to recall little memories that out at the Welker Farm out north of town. I started to recall little memories about over in Osceola at the family table when guys were sitting around, old codgers were sitting around the table at coffee over there. Careful, I'm going to be one of those old codgers soon. You know, I started to have memories of life of this guy's smile and just going, man, what's that guy got going on that he smiles that big? And it was a moment in a very different setting that I'm usually in that brought me into a place of worshiping and recognizing who God was. I don't care what name you put on it. There is one God, one Father of us all, one Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. And his Spirit can well up within you like Old Faithful, if you'll let it. Sometimes it'll be in places that you never thought you'd be. Sometimes it's out of ordinary places. But let it well up within you. And let your heart be worshipful. Work on that in life this week. Being worshipful. Because you'll never really be thankful. You'll never really be faithful. You'll never really be graceful until you recognize with a whole heart what it means to be worshipful. And as we step into a new season where we celebrate the birth of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, I hope you can do that with a full heart, ready to worship him. Come and worship. Come and worship. Worship Christ, the newborn King. We're going to stand and we're going to sing a song of invitation. And it's an invitation, really honestly, to come. I know that's not a big thing anymore for people to walk down the aisle at a church and give their life to Jesus. Oftentimes it happens afterwards, and when people are having individual conversations, that's okay too, because that happened a lot when Jesus talked to people one-on-one. But let me invite you, if you feel God move in your heart today, to worship him by taking a stand and coming for him. Not for anything else, but for him. Because once upon a time, angels that God sent shared a message. It's a message that we need to hear today. For unto you is born this day, the town of David, a Savior who is Christ the Lord. Let's sing together today as you remember that. Let's worship God as we sing this song. Come and worship.
Angels from the realms of glory, wing your flight. Worship Christ the Lord.
God bless you as you go out today. Don't forget it's Donut Sunday, but I hope you didn't just come for that. Get more excited about God than those donuts, all right? God bless you.